Cleveland, Tennessee can do better than that. Make sure they hear you out here in the hall. If you're ready for a big night, I want you to make a little bit of noise. Will you do it? Come on. Hey, this is going to be a lot of fun. Thank you for your patience. I know we're running a couple minutes behind, but you're in for a treat tonight. We're going to have an incredible conversation with someone that you already know, but I'm not even going to introduce you. In fact, I'm just going to let the video speak for itself. And then when that video is over, you guys join me in giving Tim a huge welcome, okay?
And what is the thing? You have a thing called Night to Shine.
Yes.
And what is this again?
Well, Night to Shine is a worldwide prom for people with special needs. And
worldwide. So you have a worldwide prom.
We have a worldwide prom. And at the same time, all around the world, kids with special needs are being celebrated. They're walking down red carpets. They're being cheered for. And it's my favorite night of the year.
I keep swinging for the fences. It's like this heart is defenseless. Against a passion that's pumping through my veins.
30 minutes for the rest of our lives.
Blood, sweat, tears, it's a calling. And if I can't walk, then I'm crawling. It might flicker, but they can't kill the flame. It's running deeper than the ocean. This ain't religion, it's devotion. 3, 6, 5, every minute, every day. So in the middle of the madness, they can stretch me out like canvas. But I ain't ever gonna fit in their frame.
Ben, inside the 5? Are you kidding? Tim Tebow!
I can't stop, no, I can't quit. It's in my heart, yeah, I'm on it. Till the wheels fall off, till the spotlight fades. I will lift your banner high. Lord, I'll lift your banner high. And till the walls crash in, for the rest of my days.
I know that's not why I'm here. It's not my biggest purpose. It's not my biggest calling. It's not how I want to be known in my life. It's not as a football player, as a baseball player. I want my life to be so much more than that. I want to be someone that was known for bringing faith, hope, and love to those needing a brighter day in their darkest hour of need.
Thank you.
What's up, man?
Come on, man.
Thank you.
There you go.
Thank you, guys. Thank you. Thanks. Thank you. For sure. God bless you. Thank you. Thank you. You guys sit down.
Hey, man, you got some friends here.
Well, that's got to be one of the best applauses I've ever gotten in Tennessee.
Wow.
Yeah.
Dude, let's talk about it. I mean, what is it like being a Florida Gator talking to a bunch of Tennessee Vol fans?
In Tennessee, well, for a while, it's been pretty easy. too soon? Too soon? I don't know. I feel like we have almost as many Gators in here as we do Vols. Come on. Therefore, Pastor Jordan, you should be proud because, therefore, it's a blossoming church.
Come on.
Yeah. They're learning the truth.
Hey, here's what I want to know. How many of you are legitimate Florida Gator fans?
All right. That's serious.
The rest of them just went to Academy this afternoon. Just bought some stuff.
I know, right? But I'll tell you, in the meet and greet, it was a little disturbing, though, of just how many teams that I met fans of, right? I mean, yeah. It was South Carolina. Sorry, Coach Muschamp. I just saw before I walked in, they just let him go.
Wow.
I like Will. He's a good guy. But obviously, Tennessee, Auburn. I even met a few FSU fans, and I'm like, what are they doing here? This is SEC country.
And you're pretty familiar with the SEC.
Somewhat.
A little bit. Who is your second favorite SEC team?
None. I mean, it's... I'll tell you this. The one thing that I love about the SEC more than other conferences is you hate them when you play them, But it's such a grind that when they go play someone else, you're rooting for them. You're like, oh, you know. Like I was saying this last weekend, it was like, you know, Indiana and Northwestern are ranked in the Big Ten, and we have a bunch of teams that aren't ranked. And I was like, okay, this is why you play non-conference, so that if, you know, the Auburns that were ranked 24th would play an Indiana, we would see what would happen, you know?
Yeah.
And it would be like, so you're proud of your conference because you know what a grind it is to go through. And so I think that's one of the special things. There's no other conferences that when they play, they literally chant SEC. There's a difference in the SEC and other conferences, and I think that's super cool.
Well, here's the thing. You do have a lot of Tennessee Vol fans in this area.
Okay. No one's perfect.
You've got some Auburn fans over here. I know that there's a couple over here that are big Auburn fans. Here's the thing, though. Even Auburn fans and Tennessee fans, they have to admit that you're one of the great college football players of all time. They have to admit it.
I don't know if they would all have to, but, you know, it's... I'll tell you one of the interesting things is just how personal the SEC is. And I remember when I was a recruit, we finished up a game on Friday night. We got into the car my senior year of high school. My dad drove. Me and our right guard, who was the number one guard in the country, ended up going to Florida. Wise kid. We drove to Tennessee, and we slept. My dad drove. And we woke up, time for the game. We go into the game. No one says anything. And we're like, okay, maybe it's because the game already started. Literally, no coach said hello to us. Hi, thanks for coming, anything. And so we're like, okay, maybe it's just their focus, big game, whatever. Tennessee wins by a field goal, last second field goal. They win the game. After the game, all the recruits go into the locker room. Phil's up there saying, hey, you know, blah, blah, blah. This is what happens if you come to Tennessee. You win big games like this, to all the recruits and the teams up there, blah, blah, blah. And there's a quarterback who's also a recruit standing about 15 feet away from me. And he looks at him and he says, this is why you're going to come to Tennessee and be the next great quarterback at Tennessee. And I'm standing 15 feet away from him. That night, no one said anything to me. So literally, we finish up. They're all celebrating or celebrating him. And we walk out of the door, and one of their coaches, Jimmy Ray Stevens, a really good man, strong believer, comes walking up to us as we're leaving and puts his hand around my shoulder. And he's like, I'm so sorry. You know, I just want you to know we really want you. And I was like, I totally get that. I can tell. And so we're on the field, you know, the one where they chant Rocky Top, you'll always be second in the SEC.
Wow.
And,
wow.
Oh, is that not how it goes? Oh, sorry. I guess that's the version we sing. And so we're walking, and you know, it probably was a mixture of like a little bit of arrogance, Jordan, but it also was probably just a little bit of like pride and love for my dad. And I was so upset, but not just because it was them choosing another quarterback over me, but my dad drove all the way here for nothing. And I put my arm around my dad. We're walking out with our right guard. And I just say to dad, I said, Dad, I just want you to know I'm super grateful you drove me all this way. And I'm sorry that it went like this, but I'll tell you what, I don't know where I'm gonna go to school. But wherever I go, we're coming back here, and it's going to be a different outcome.
Wow.
And I'll tell you, you know, it sounds like kind of whatever, you know, small-minded or whatever, but that's how personal it is in the SEC. Every little bit. You know everybody. You know everybody on their side. They know you. You know every little detail. I played against all the guys from Tennessee and Alabama and LSU. A lot of them in the All-American games in high school. You played against them in college, and you played against them in the NFL. Shoot, when I went to the Broncos, pretty much the entire Chiefs defense came from the SEC, especially LSU. Their front seven, five of the front seven, I played against every year at LSU. So you kind of get to know each other. It's not that big of a world of these guys. And so it just becomes really personal. And that's why, like what we say in the SEC, it just means more, because it really does.
Yeah, that's awesome. Your journey didn't start in the SEC, though. You started playing football. Well, how old were you when you started playing football?
Six, about to turn seven.
All right. Tell me about your journey. What does that journey look like for Tim Tebow playing the game of football leading up to that moment in the SEC?
I'll tell you what, it was a lot of ups and downs, and a lot of you can't do this, you're not good enough, you won't make it, from some of the time I started playing to when I got to high school. And my freshman year, they said, the team's going to be better with you as a linebacker and tight end. And honestly, you'll probably never play quarterback here. So I played linebacker and tight end. We were blessed to win the state championship, but my dream was to play quarterback. So we left and we looked at all the other schools in the area, and we found a school that just had hired a coach named Craig Howard. And we went and met him. And within 5 minutes, I looked at my dad, because my dad was super supportive, and I never would have had the chance if my dad wasn't supportive of my dream, because he was literally willing to move to give me a chance to play quarterback when other people weren't. And I met him 5 minutes of meeting Coach Howard. I looked at my dad and I said, this is the coach I'm supposed to play for. And so we literally moved so I could play there. And on the cover of the Jacksonville Times Union, it was Tebow goes from champion to joke or something like that. Moving, playing to Nice High School, where we were 2-8 that year, 1-9 the year before that, hadn't been to the playoffs in over 10 years, never won a state championship. And that year, we had 10 games, 5 at home, 5 on the road. We played 6 homecoming games, ours and every single one of our road games. And I'm not sure if you know why you're homecoming, because you suck. And so literally every team thought that about us. And that first year, we went 5-5, and then we were literally, I was going down classrooms. I was homeschooled still. I was literally going to classrooms saying, hey, you want to try out for the football team? You want to try out for the football team? We're not going to be as bad this year. And then the next year, we went 11-2, and then my senior year, we won the state championship. And that was so cool, because it literally was just buy-in of the team, buy-in of what Coach Howard had to say. And you know what's cool about Coach Howard is he led us to our first ever state championship, and then got the head coaching job at Southern Oregon NAI, won a championship there. And then I got to the championship again the next year, and then unfortunately passed away. And what was so cool is the impact that a head coach can have, because I flew to Southern Oregon to speak at his funeral, and there were probably over 1,000 players there, and over 10,000 people showed up to his funeral. Most of them were impacted by the way that he taught his players. And I can still tell you all of his lessons that I learned as a sophomore in high school. Do what's right. Do your best. Treat others the way you want to be treated. It's our job to love. It's our job to love. Love you, it's your job to love one another. Like, I could go on and on about every single one of his speeches. But it's amazing how someone that brings a new philosophy and is willing to change and is willing to adapt and is willing to do it the right way, get people to buy in, to believe in something bigger than themselves, how they can change something that everybody else said was, oh, it'll just continue this way because that's not a football school. But it was such a good example of how something has the ability to change if you're willing to do something different than it's ever been done. And that was a huge example to me, and that really led me up to going to the University of Florida after that.
Faith has always been the thing that identifies who Tim Tebow is. You can say you're a great football player, and you are. You're a great multi-sport athlete, and you are. But at the end of the day, what's going to be remembered about you is that you're a man of great faith. And I want to talk a little bit about your faith, because that really is the thing I believe that sets you apart. I mean, going all the way back to way back when, to the thing called Tebowing. Man, you kind of coined that, but what it was you spending time with the Lord and you giving glory to God. I mean, talk to us about that real quick. I mean, what was it?
I didn't coin that. There were a lot of people that had done that before I was even around. To me, that was more of just a God thing that he did with people. I never said it before. I just did it. And it would be one thing if, and you know, it's even funny when a lot of people bring it up, they say, oh, it's Tebowing. That's what, you know, Tebow did after he scored a touchdown. I never did it after I scored a touchdown. I've never done it after I scored a touchdown. It was literally something that I did before and after a game when I found the most quietest spot on the field, which is when you get to that level, there are no quiet spots. You just find whatever you can near the sidelines or the bench, and the cameras find you. But it wasn't something that I started when I was even at Florida or with the Broncos. It was something I started my sophomore year at Nice High School, because it was important to me to talk to God and ask him before what was a big moment for me. And there would be eyes that I would have the courage in the heart to honor him with my actions and my words and the highs, and that I would give it to him in the lows. And whatever happened in that game, that he would honestly get the glory from it. And that there would be something that could be done that would bring people to know him. and that there would be some way that we could make this more than a game.
Yeah.
And then just through some games in the NFL when I was doing it, and then actually, I actually think it was from more from adversity that that became popular, because when I got sacked by one of the Lions, he Tebowed on me. And then just it started going all the time. And then when we were on the winning streak, they would just snap to you after a game or before a game doing it. And but what's cool wasn't the hype and it wasn't the talk. I mean, it was cool that prayer was being talked about. But what's cool was, man, the young kids that were in high school that would send me letters and say, man, you know, I just decided that, man, our team won't pray before games, but I'm going to do it. And now 30 of our team is doing it with me before a game. And then to hear the testimonies of it, is that was cool for me, because, it, you know, if you could just encourage one young person to step out in faith, then it was going to be worth it. And I'm so grateful I had that encouragement from my parents when I was young, but also different players like Danny Werfel that I would see him put his hands together. And, you know, I would think, as a six-year-old boy, man, if he could do it, maybe one day if I had that chance, maybe I could do it. And even when you think about those moments, is yes, you want to think about winning and doing good and being successful. But if that's all you did was win or lose games, it wouldn't be worth a lot.
Yeah.
And I think one of the greatest forms of tragedy in the world today is being successful, but in things that don't matter. And I think there's going to be a lot of people that get to the end of their life and they turn around and they look back and they say, man, I was successful, but in nothing that mattered. And guys, every single one of us, we have a chance. We have a chance to take every bit of success in our life and turn it into significance, because we have the platform and the opportunity to do that. You have it. It might be on a stage of 5 or 5 million, but you have it. Every one of us, where we don't have to look back and say, man, I wish I would have. There's so many things I look back on my life and I think, man, I just missed it. I just miss it. I don't want to miss it anymore. I don't want to miss that chance to be able to share. I don't want to miss that chance to encourage. I don't want to miss that chance to love. I don't want to miss that chance to talk to a high school kid that might look up to me. Every single one of us has that chance. All different chances. Don't miss it. Because one day when you're looking back on your life, what do you think are going to be the things that matter more? Those times and those moments when you had chances to change eternity for someone. Or, you know what, I'm just going to get caught up with keeping up with the Joneses with Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. Because let me tell you, every week it's going to start over. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. And you can get caught up in a lot of things. But one day you're going to realize it's not going to mean that much.
Let's talk about the one thing that makes Tim Tebow different than a bunch of the people of the world. Tell me how you met Jesus, man. Tell me about the change that Jesus has made in your life.
I grew up son of pastors, missionaries, and heard about Jesus almost every day. And we went to church all the time. We were one of those families, Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, hit a couple Bible studies in between, you know. But it wasn't until I was laying in my bed one night and I was scared because I knew I didn't know Jesus. And I was so afraid that I was going to get in a car and get in a crash. And I didn't know the hope that the rest of my family had in Jesus. So I got out of bed and I ran to my mom and I said, Mom, I got to ask Jesus into my heart now. And she said, okay, let me go get your dad. I said, no, we don't have time. And we were in the living room and I got on my knees and I asked Jesus to come into my heart and forgive me my sins. And he did. And instantly in that moment, I knew I went from darkness to light. My eternity was sealed and I was adopted into the family of God. And it was the best decision that I've ever made. So I think it's different things that cause all of us to trust Jesus. For some people, it's his love on the cross. For others, it might be his, you know, what he had to say and his kindness. But for me, I knew I was missing something. There was a piece of me, and you say, oh, you were just a boy. How did you know? I knew. There was a piece of me that was missing. That was missing. And I believe what Jesus did on the cross and that it counted for me. And I couldn't fully tell you every bit of it then, but I knew it. I knew it. This guy, he died on the cross. And man, I knew he did it for me. And it couldn't wait. I had to ask him now. Now. Because there is a sense of urgency, or there better be, with Jesus. Because that day he was knocking on the door of my heart. He wasn't going to force his way in. I had to choose to accept him. But how many lives around the world right now in this moment while we're sitting here in an awesome church don't have hope, don't know about Jesus, have no love, are being thrown away, are being forgotten, and are being viewed as less than? You see, what I believe is part of our mission, part of the great mission, it is a mission. And in that mission is a sense of urgency. There is a timeline for it. And I want to ask you a question. Are we living on our timeline? And you know probably what most people is, oh, hey, I'm 33, when I'm 45, I'm going to retire, I'm going to save enough, I'm going to give to the church, I'm going to tithe, and then I'm probably going on a couple mission trips so I feel real good about myself. And or am I so called to the mission that every life that doesn't know Jesus, that's being thrown away, that's forgotten, that's neglected, that's not important, am I going to live on their timeline? You see, that's one of my non-negotiables for my life. And for our foundation, is that we're a rescue mission, is that we're on a rescue mission. See, that puts a timeline. When's the last time you heard of a rescue mission that's taking place next year? No, rescue says now. It's a sense of urgency. It is a rescue mission. For what? For who? For humanity, for every single person that Jesus died for. You see, the church is not a building that we're supposed to just come to. The church is a body of believers that believe what Jesus did on the cross, that accounted for him, and that are willing to do life together, and then to go tell the world. That's what the church is. You're fortunate to do it in a big building, but are we living out the mission of the church? That's right. The Great Commission, and the mission that's supposed to be on your life and on my life, because there's a huge difference between showing up at church and living out the calling on our lives. It's drastically different. And so for me and my calling is for every single day that I have, for every single moment that we have, it's to rescue one more. And we don't stop until we've gotten to every single person, till I go home to heaven or till Jesus comes back. To me, that's what a rescue mission is. And that's what I feel like I'm called to. Because what Jesus did on the cross, it counted for me and it counts for every single person. And we got to get to him, and we got to tell him.
All right, we're going to continue in worship today by lifting up a new song to the Lord. The Bible talks about lifting a new song to him, not only with our mouths, but with our hearts. Let's celebrate his victory today. Let's sing this out. Let praise be a weapon.
Let praise be a weapon that silences the enemy.
That's right.
Let praise be a weapon that conquers all anxiety. Let it rise. Let praise arise. We sing your name in the dark and it changes everything.
That's right.
We sing with all we are and claim your victory. Let praise arise.
This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like.